presentation is also on behalf of my colleague Jan van Doesburg. I will discuss the topic of the landscapes in the Netherlands and from an archaeological or more from a management perspective. First, I will give a short overview of castle sites in the Netherlands in general. And then I will talk about castle sites and their surroundings, and I will end with castles and heritage management, more the daily practice. The overview of castles in the Netherlands, when we take a look at them, it's clear that the political situation determines the construction of the buildings. In the Netherlands, local and regional secular and religious elite are responsible for the most important part. Territorial rulers such as earls, dukes and bishops are responsible for a minority of the castles. The eldest castles were built around 1000 AD. Most of them were built, however, between 1200 and 1400 AD, and the castle building ended around 1550 AD. This is now the visible castles and the periods they are dated. There's a variety of shapes and sizes, ranging from solitary tower houses to large square and round castles with a bailey. The oldest castles were timber built. After 1200 AD, brick and in few cases natural stone were used as main building material. As there are in the Netherlands no mountains and a few hills, the castles were sometimes placed on artificial earthen platforms. Almost all castles are surrounded by one or more moats. Most of them had a defensive and a residential function. Only a few had primarily a military function. After the Middle Ages, a large number of the castles was transformed into country houses surrounded by parks, woodlands and arable lands. Farms were also part of it. They became estates. Other castles were torn down, only the moats remained and are still visible in the landscape. The castles are not evenly spread across the Netherlands. As you can see, most castles are situated in the north, middle and south of the country. There's a clear distinction in the visible and invisible castle sites, the archaeological ones. So on the left hand you see the visible ones, and on the right hand you see the archaeological ones. Especially in the provinces of Groningen, up to the north, in Zeeland, to the southwest, and in the south, to a lesser degree, there are concentrations of archaeological castle sites, which are nowadays hardly visible in the landscape. In the northern part, the dense distribution is due to the political situation. It lacks a central government and the society can be characterized as a void society, where local elite families fought each other. Most castles in this area were relatively small brick tower houses and tower keeps. Some were placed on artificial mounds. Castles are situated on stream ridges or in or near villages. Often several castles lay close to each other. Most of them, however, were torn down after the Middle Ages. The transformation into country houses rarely exists in this area, as you can see that on the right side. There's nothing, they're all archaeological sites. One of the, an example is this one, which is, it's beautiful, but only the tower building remains here on this land. The rest is all, it's a farmhouse from the 19th century or so. The rest is all archaeological things that remain. I show a lot of pictures from castle sites in the Netherlands, and in most cases on the upper side you see the location, and on the right hand in the gray pattern, that's the protected area of the site. So as you can see, and what we will see during this presentation, is that only a small part is protected as a monument. Then we go to the south of the Netherlands. The distribution is linked to the political situation. In almost every village, castles were built, of which a large number still exists, some intact or transformed into a country house. Others became ruins. The castles were built by local or regional elite families. In the south we see larger, mostly rectangular brick or stone castles with a bailey. The site location is variable. Some are located near rivers or streams, like the Meuse, and other on higher locations in the landscape, on prominent places. Due to the natural hilly landscape in the very south, artificial mounds are a minority. One example is Valkenburg, and I will come back later to this site. I come back to it later on. In the middle of the country, the Central River area, we find several clusters of castles, castle sites and estates. This concentration is both caused by the political development of the area as well as the reclamations, so-called copes, that were carried out here in 12th and 13th century. Castles were built here predominantly by members of elite groups, both secular and ecclesiastical, who participated in the reclamations. Furthermore, this area was in the Middle Ages the border area between the county of Holland and the secular part of the bishopry of Utrecht. So apart from reclamation reasons, rivers formed attractive settlement locations. So in this area we see castles near villages and towns as well as groups of castles in reclamation areas. This is one example of a very nicely preserved castle. A moated site with bailey dating from the late 13th century. Then I come to the second part. Castles influence the development of their surrounding landscapes, leading in some cases to castle or elite landscapes. The Dutch castles we know are connected with settlements. Some of the settlements rose near the castles. In Dutch, the toponym Stein or Stein indicates its connection. This does not appear for not account for the Burg toponym. A few examples are IJsselstein, as you see here. This is the castle and the village nearby. What's left is the tower. From the 14th century onwards, castles were built in existing villages and towns. The reasons differ, for instance, to control cities or to achieve a city-state. Another example of a castle built in a town is Utrecht, in the middle of the country. Here, a monastery was demolished to build the castle. What remains of the castle nowadays, if someone visits or comes to Utrecht by train or by car, in the parking lot you find the remains of the castle, and it's even not on the spot where it's found, so it's exitu. Another example is what I told before, in the middle of the country we can find castles connected to the reclamations. An example is the Langbroek Wetering, which can be found of a lead of castle landscape. On the top, all the dots are castles. You see there's a reclamation X, and this is one of those castles left. And you see also the influence on the environment. This is a road, it runs. Passed by castle and church. So this is a pretty intact landscape still left. I showed a few examples of castles. What they have in common is that we know little about the immediate surroundings of associated gardens, parks, deer parks, ponds, farms, and the impact of castles on the landscape. Therefore, we cannot compare the Dutch situation, for instance, the British or the Irish situation. The lack of research into the relationship between castles, their immediate environment and the landscape can be explained in part by the strong emphasis in Dutch castle research on military and political functions, the building themselves and the genealogical aspects. There was less attention for the social and economic functioning of the castles in relation to the environment. And this brings us to the third part of the presentation. the heritage management. The consequence of the lack of attention and knowledge about the environment is also visible in the protection measures. Often, only the main castle island is protected as a listed building or listed monument at all. If there are no visual remains of the building left, the site can be protected as an archaeological monument. For these monuments counts the same. Often, the protection is restricted to the main building. Even baileys are in the most cases not protected. Only if castles are transformed into estates, so from 1550 AD onwards, the gardens and parks are often protected. The problem is also that if a castle is protected as a built monument, that does not mean that the archaeological remains are protected, or that they have to do archaeological research if there are development plans. This depends on the policy of the municipality. So the interest in the past for the main building and its history can be seen in the protection regime. Only recently the awareness of the surrounding area is growing. Was archaeological research in the past mainly restricted to the moated area? Now we have a few examples of archaeological research of the gardens and park areas. The reason for the research is often to bring back the old splendor. Archaeological research provides input on the questions of which phase of the landscape must be restored. So historical, geographical and archaeological research is increasingly being conducted to obtain information. To summarize, in general, elements such as gardens, parks, ponds, farmsteads and surrounding parceling systems are often not legally protected. These elements are under pressure. In the Netherlands, you can say space is scarce and they are therefore in high demand. The maintenance of castles and estates becomes more and more expensive, and owners often see sale of parts of their property as a solution. So, castles that are connected with their environment and original functional context are becoming rarer. The influence of castles on the new landscape developments is reduced to historical references. The castles themselves become tourist attractions and are used as venues for parties, weddings and fairs. There is also much interest in castle ruins and sites from municipalities, private developers and as a public. And many castles are redeveloped and ruins are consolidated or in some cases castles are rebuilt. So reconnecting castles with the cultural landscape is not yet an issue in the Netherlands. I will give a few examples of developments on archaeological monuments and also on built monuments. This is one of them. It's an archaeological monument. It's an 11th century moated site. There has been an excavation in 1906, and in 2016 you see exactly the same trench with exactly the same features left. So it's well preserved. But now, as one of the management questions, only 2 weeks ago I got a question from Nature Reserve, who owns the area. They want to dug out the ditch because they have goals for nature, so they need some frogs back or something. So they need water, and with a hot climate in the Netherlands even this year, they want to deepen the ditches. So that's it's an archaeological monument, so we said no, we don't want to, because there are medieval paleontological rests still in that mode. Another example is Bukor Salt, that's also a castle site. What you see there is only the moat, which is visible in the landscape. There's a farmhouse on top of it. Almost 20 years ago, the owner wants to redevelop it. He wants to build apartment buildings on this area. We are in charge and we said they can build apartments, but only on the already disturbed parts of this site. So there's a 20th century farmhouse and even a very large stable. That's where they can build things. But because of the economic crisis everything stopped. Then there was an idea to make a horse riding farm, etc. And nowadays there are new ideas to make to build apartments.
Something is going wrong. Lighter. Oh, this one.
This is in the reclamation area. Several motorcycles. They are beautiful. And you see the parceling, which you can't see anything, but during the medieval period and afterwards, they're still there. So even nowadays, it has some function or in the society. They don't change the pattern of the areas. This is also from the reclamation areas, you see. The pressure on the landscape. This is an area there, at the moment, they are going to build 35,000 homes in these surroundings. You see it everywhere. But only just the small side of the castle, that's left. The rest will all vanish. Yeah, I have to hurry up. Another example, exactly the same. This is what is left because it's in a Dutch defense structure from the 18th, 19th century. This is an example where archaeological research was conducted to the gardens. This is one of the good examples. Here you see also the apartment buildings near the castle site. This is the townhouse and the castle. This is also the community wanted this. This is a local initiative. Here they want to build apartment buildings. The heritage organization, they want to stop it. But this is the idea of the municipality. And this is also the castle. The castle is increasing every year. They're going to build new parts of the castles to use it for weddings and parties. And this was the Valkenburg one. There was also a local initiative. They want to rebuild parts of the castle, this local material. They want to dig that local material, marble, limestone. But they've forgotten that also the limestone is underneath a subsurface landscape. It will be completely destroyed. Whereas these, the municipality, they liked it very much. Also the province liked to do it, but then they didn't thought about what would be destroyed. So now organizations are against it, and now the plan is still back to normal. Only this is a good example. They want to remove some buildings built in the past because of the view of the castle. May I say some? My conclusion. Sorry for
final word.
Yeah, the final words. That's true. To conclude, this was not a very cheerful story about the Dutch castles and their surroundings. To see that the awareness of environment of castles and their influence on the landscape is growing, as we saw in this last example, is positive. Combined historical, geographical and archaeological research is necessary to gain more information about castles and their setting. Researchers from different disciplines, but also heritage management organizations, can collaborate more intensively. The results of research and different interests can then be better coordinated. However, the most important thing, in my opinion, is to tell residents and other stakeholders the whole story about castle and its surroundings. Involve them. Only if there is support for the preservation of valuable, invisible archaeological remains, landscape elements, allotment systems, etc., will these be preserved, and not only as a historical reference in the naming of a new residential area. Thank you.